Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the SAIE Cable Theft Chapter webinar on essential infrastructure theft and vandalism mitigation. Before we start, a few webinar considerations. Attendees are reminded to ensure the volume is turned up on their device. Ensure you have a stable internet connection. This will ensure the streaming and audio will run smoothly. Attendees can ask questions via the questions panel located within the GoToWebinar control panel. By default, the control panel is located on the right-hand side of your screen. The chat function is reserved for webinar organizers and panelists to communicate with attendees. Attendees will not be able to chat with each other, however, are encouraged to ask questions. A recording of this webinar will be made available on the SAIE YouTube channel, SAIE TV, under the Cable Theft playlist. You will find the registration link in the chat box and other links for your consideration. Please register, it is free. A certificate of attendance will be issued a few days after this webinar. Before I introduce you to Gavin, our first speaker tonight, I just want to raise that you will find handouts in the handout section, the October issue of the What Now magazine that you can download in PDF format, and you can also find the SAIE Training Academy brochure, where we have various courses where you can earn CPD credits. Now, for setting the scene tonight, I'd like to introduce you now to Mr. Gavin Strelick, who's a technical specialist for working for Eskom, and he received his BSc in Electrical Engineering at the University of Witwatersrand in 97. He obtained his MSc with distinction in 2016 and is pursuing his PhD in lightning protection. He has been a registered professional engineer since 2003 and has more than 20 years of related experience in the electricity utility industry with Eskom. He has been involved in several areas, including design, technology management, and standardization. He is presently in Eskom's research department, focusing on insulation coordination. He is also involved in several industry working groups to mitigate cable theft. Over to you, Gavin.
Thanks, Wings. That's a very flattering introduction. I wonder who wrote it. Anyway, I was very fortunate to be called into this to make an introduction. I have a passion for fighting cable theft generally, but of course this impacts on different areas, insulated cables, earthing, and I've been more involved on the earthing side in the past, but of late we are looking at insulated cables, bus bars, and these issues affect most of the areas. So I wanted to start off by saying that it's a truism that the determined thief will stop at nothing. And I think this statement is not useful because in a way it's like we are admitting defeat. Why must we even try? Because there will always be someone that will find a way. So personally, I never want to hear that again, and I actually complain when people bring it up. But sometimes I think we're a little bit easily disappointed. Whatever measures we put in place don't seem to work as well as we would like. And nevertheless, when you make theft more difficult or the act of theft less lucrative, it certainly brings about a statistical improvement. And we need to now, as engineers and people in industry, systematically identify which are the approaches that bring the most favorable cost to benefit ratio. So we need to be a bit more scientific about it, I guess. And Quentin will look into it in quite some detail in his presentation. So to my mind, there are several strategies, and one that I favor is actually trying to remove the incentive of theft, or to at least reduce the incentive. And this is by using alternative materials that have less inherent value for components like cables. So if you use aluminium instead of copper, that's certainly a move in the right direction. So of course, the engineering challenge is to ensure that we don't affect the technical performance that we need, the ratings and other performance issues, by changing to an alternative technology. There are a number of deterrent approaches, and I think Quentin will expand on that quite extensively, such as increasing the security, restricting access to these items. And these approaches are certainly necessary for existing infrastructure. And others we can mention, such as marking certain items to improve the traceability. These things serve as a deterrent. So in my opinion, a lot of the deterrent approaches produce disappointing results. And the question I'm also going to pose is, why are we not pursuing proactively replacing high theft items before they're actually stolen? Many of these items, like copper cables, there's a very high recovery value, which can then be used to offset the project costs. It's not to say now that we're going to dig up cables that have been in the ground for 20 years and replace them, but there are opportunities in substations to replace cables during projects for theft deterrent alternatives. So in some cases, of course, multiple interventions are necessary. It's not good enough to just follow one approach and expect excellent results. So sometimes it just seems like we are moving the goalposts, but the point is we are moving them in the right direction. So it is still a good effort and worth it. So for example, if you were to replace a copper cable with an aluminium version, the copper version will fetch approximately 10 times more scrap value than the equivalent aluminium cable. So that's certainly moving the goalpost to an alternative metal, but it's certainly in the right direction. So it's obvious that if you eliminate copper, it will just mean that would-be thieves would look for the next most valuable item in the hierarchy, which could be stainless steel or aluminium and so on. So I personally believe in, and if you've ever heard anything about what I've had to say about the theft issue, I believe that ultimately we should be making a strong drive towards bimetallic conductors, which have been well proven and really substantially reduce the scrap value to pretty much a pittance. So these technologies have been proven internationally and I believe are a good option, certainly for new infrastructure. So I just wanted to say in conclusion to this introduction that Quinton is very experienced. He's looked into these issues very deeply, very scientifically. And so I am personally very much looking forward to hearing what Quinton has to say. And I would also looking forward to the opportunity to ask him some questions. So with that, over to Quinton.
Thank you, Gavin. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to now introduce you to Mr. Quinton Lowe, who is a Managing Director of Ntamo Nexus Technologies. And he's the founder, like I said, founder and Managing Director of Ntamo Nexus Technologies, a company specializing in mitigating essential infrastructure crimes with early warning and preventative strategies focusing on customer revenue protection. He holds a Bachelor of Engineering and Master of Engineering from University of Johannesburg, and has published various conference papers and journal articles in the discipline. I'd like to now hand you over to Quinton. Over to you, Quinton.
Thank you very much, Minx, and thank you for the introduction. Also, thanks to Gavin for setting the scene. I just want to confirm, can everyone see the presentation and hear me clearly?
Yes, please proceed.
Thank you very much, Minx. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for your valuable time, this time of the afternoon. Hopefully, with what I share with you today, will give you a different perspective on how we actually deal with a problem and the results that are forthcoming from that. I think just to set the scene, this is an extract from the South African government website this year, where, and I think that sums it up, vandalism and theft of public infrastructure poses a great risk to our nation and our people, and there is a need for decisive action to protect our vital infrastructure. Transnet, Eskom, and South African Police Services have all indicated that the theft of copper and ferrous metal has reduced but remains at very high levels and continues to cause considerable damage to the infrastructure and to the economy. tonight's presentation is about understanding the problem first. Whenever we tackle this thing from an engineering perspective, we need to have a clear, definitive problem statement, because you cannot apply a solution if you don't comprehensively understand the problem. And therefore, I'll just take you through a short agenda of the presentation. We'll look at some introductory remarks, understanding the problem, what is the economic impact, what compounds this problem, legislation around it, how this problem is currently managed, what is the panacea for revenue improvement, looking at a paradigm shift in our thinking in terms of approaching this particular problem. Then I'll share a case study with the city of Ekurhuleni, showing some empirical data on a strategy that was implemented and how that improved the situation. And then we'll move on to look at outcomes-based solutions, some recommendation, conclusion, and then we'll close. So just some introductory remarks, just so that we understand from where I come from, is that when we look at energy losses in a power system, it's directly proportional to revenue losses. So energy losses is a summation of the generated energy, less the technical losses, as well as the non-technical losses. Now, technical losses we can quantify by calculation and we can apply those, but non-technical losses can be very difficult to determine. And those in the majority of instances where we find ourselves now is actually higher than that of the technical losses. But just one point to mention from a technical perspective is that when we increase the non-technical losses, in some instances, we increase the technical losses as well, specifically in distribution transformers in the illegal connection space. As we overload those transformers, we generate an immense amount of heat in that transformer, and that heat obviously affects the properties of that particular device, and therefore we start suffering higher technical losses. The second introductory remark that I would just like to share with you, and this is more specifically around electrical distribution networks, is that we'll focus on non-technical losses, and it has a combination of aspects that affect that, and that typically would be the meter accuracies, the culture of non-payment, admin, and then non-ferrous metal theft and illegal connections. Tonight's presentation is in majority focusing on non-ferrous metal theft and to a lesser amount illegal connections. We'll touch on those. So let's define the problem. I've actually got a couple of short videos I'd like to show you, and let me show you this one first. What we see in this particular video, there's a couple of aspects. Usually cable theft's time is anything from after 8 o'clock at night till about 4 o'clock in the morning. Yeah, we find guys actually digging out quite a substantial amount and removing that cable right in front of the police station. So it's done with impunity in broad daylight. They've been busy there for some time. And in these cases, generally, it is a high-risk type of environment. Usually, these suspects have firearms with them. So it can just show you how relaxed they are in actually doing this right in front of the police station and nothing coming from that. The second, and apologies for the poor amateur videos, but it's there and for us to share and to have a look at. This is an associated life-threatening danger, which is as a result of illegal connections on a distribution pole top transformer. Hello, So one can see the impact, the innocent in and around that environment being affected by illegal connections. Although being a social problem, the impact and the consequences thereof can be quite catastrophic. So when we look at the manifestation of the problem from a global perspective, we typically find these type of items. I can show you many more, but I'm sure in your environment you've seen a lot of this these problems occurring. But the reason for this is the unscrupulous recycle market. That is the where everything gets fed to. So the recycle market, or the unscrupulous recycle market, is in particular a main contributor to this problem. I would like to show you what the perception of a cable thief is in this particular environment.
I've arranged to meet someone who knows how these gangs work from the inside. We've agreed to speak to each other in an undisclosed location outside of town. How sophisticated are these criminal gangs?
Some organized crime, which we are plenty guys. Some of them, they were trained, and some of them, they used to be in the army, the security, and some of them, they used to be police officers.
Are you ever scared of being caught?
We're not afraid of being caught. We're unstoppable. That was the way. If you come, we fire back, and we fire back for sure. Even the police, the private securities, if they enter to that area, it's going to be war.
Did you ever feel like you're putting your life at risk?
Especially, I do worry about my safety. I don't just release information to anybody, because you could die for that info. We had a couple of guys that dying, executed, some with electricity, some they're shot, some they're wounded. They're abused with the leaders of the gang. Sometimes they're threatened, or sometimes they're beaten, and sometimes they don't get money. It's a big risk at times when we do something. If we don't know, because we are playing on the live wire. And then I've got two other guys which I know, they don't even have one side of their hands. It was electrocuted.
The electricity, you mean, that has cut their arm off?
Yes.
How much were you making as a copper thief?
You see, copper, it's fast cash. It's fast money. It's money which you can get today. So it's something which you say, okay, I take today, I got 5,000. Tomorrow, if I go there, I'll get another 5,000. And I have to pay rent. And I need my kids to eat. It's only about money. Money talks, especially here in South Africa.
So that sets the scene in terms of that perspective. And I think the critical part out of that particular interview is how quick we can actually get cash for copper. So industries that continue to be affected, it's not just electricity industries, it's the construction, the water and sanitation, transport. So there's a whole host of industries that are severely affected by this connivance. And we must understand that, yes, electricity is quite a significant part, because they probably use most of the distribution copper, but other areas are just as affected. Basically, where there is copper available and to some extent aluminium, that particular area is going to be targeted. So, yes, there are some engineering solutions that are out there. In the telecom industry, I think they are less susceptible to particular problems, because although they get targeted, we just know how Telkom has experienced the theft incidents, as well as MTN and Vodacom and so on. But they can use fiber and wireless to some extent. In some instances, they still dependent on supply authorities. And to embark on this particular project, I know one of the telecommunications companies in Botswana has just done this. It doesn't just get done overnight. It's a huge capital expenditure, and it takes a couple of years for them to remove the copper and obviously fiber out the networks where they need to. Alternative materials can be used in place of copper, such as aluminium, but aluminium must be used for the same characteristic requirements. However, this can become a problem, such as the start of the millennium, when aluminium was outpriced copper. I'm not sure if the audience is aware, but in the early 2000s, aluminium fetched a higher price than that of copper, and it's for that reason that Eskom specifically started marking their aluminium conductors for that that reason. Then there's copper cladded steel for earthing requirements, combining materials such as copper and brass. That was an initiative Transnet at one stage took, so that when the materials are smelted into the raw product format, that solution is tainted. But we're years ahead, and this can now be bypassed with a separation process. I will allude to that particular issue with what is actually happening with the export of copper in South Africa now. Then we can remove redundant cable in order not to provide the opportunity to continue feeding the recycle market, but this is a capital intensive program. There's another alternative to put mechanical devices in the ground to clamp down the cables. However, the criminal elements, they also do their homework. So they just cut between the cable clamps. If they take 10 meters or 5 meters of cable, that's enough for one evening's work. So then that whole network is obviously compromised. So looking at the copper market, copper demand outweighs supply globally at this stage. 32% of the global copper demand comes from the recycle market, of which 85% goes to China. This is current. The copper price is touching 200 rand a kilogram. And in our case, when the rate of exchange, rand versus US dollar, goes as high as it did, up past the 19 mark, it is very lucrative for South African unscrupulous traders to be selling that copper. Just a point of interest is that the price of copper at the coast, the recycle price fetches a higher price than that year on the rand. And the reason for that is obviously the logistics that are associated with that. But it's predicted the copper price will reach 400 rand a kilogram in 2030. Copper use in renewables is 4 to 6 times more than that in fossil fuels. So if we look at the South African the scrap environment, the legal scrap metal industry contributes 15 billion rand to South African GDP, of which copper accounts only 2% by volume, but by value exceeds most other scrap metal dealers. In November 2021, South Africa exported almost $1 billion of copper into the foreign market. And not long after that, because of this particular problem, an embargo was imposed that we only export copper. Well, the embargo was put in place that no copper would be exported between certain times. But what a lot of people don't know is that was only raw copper. So the recyclers got very clever and started putting impurities in the copper, smelted down into ingots, ship them out to the Chinas, and in Chinas they will do a separation process to extract the raw copper. So that circumvented the whole process. The recycler scrap dealer market in South Africa, there's poor regulation. There's very good legislation, but there's poor regulation at this stage. We have the best legislation in the world, believe it or not, but it's poorly enforced and administered. According to S&P Global, it forecasts a global shortfall of 1.6 million tons of copper by 2035. An Anglo-American end of last year at the COP conference highlighted that we currently use about 23 kilograms per person. This is on a global perspective, but this will increase to about 230 kilograms per person with all the renewables, et cetera, that are being put into play within the market. So why is copper so attractive? It's highly conductive, it's malleable, corrosion resistant, and it's antimicrobial. It can be recycled repeatedly without any loss in performance, and it's very easily accessible. It is cheaper to reproduce than the conventional primary production. Scrap metal dealers now are buying smelting ovens, which uses less energy and it's much cheaper to actually take this copper and smelt it down into ingots. One of the drawbacks is once it's granulated or shredded, it's virtually impossible to trace ownership and sold to the purchaser, not even being aware of the fact that he's buying or she's buying stolen copper. And the illicit copper trading finds its way in these processes through the laundering alongside the legal copper trading. So if it's not caught early, it's a particular problem. So the recycled copper is a concomitant to the actual problem. And that's where everyone always says address the market. Yes, we definitely need to address the market, but it's in mechanisms of how we address the market that will make a difference. So just to give you an idea of where the copper price is currently, as well as the aluminium price, this is the price levels for the last 12 months. You'll see in March, we reached over 205 Rand a kilogram. For copper. And the analysts predict that copper's price will reach roughly $20 in per kilogram in the next 5 years or so, which is almost double of what you're looking at now. And the copper demand will increase with 50% between now and 2040. So what is the estimated cost to the South African economy? The Department of Trade and Industry commissioned an independent body to actually do an analysis and to try and establish what is the actual cost to the South African economy. And that figure, which is available in the media, was anything, there's a dispute, or not a dispute, but there's a variance, anything from 45 to 47 billion Rand a year. However, if you take the consequential effect into account, it could be anything closer to 200 billion Rand a year. Now, 47 billion Rand doesn't sound a lot of money. But like a lot of money. But when you break it down into figures that we can probably understand, it's 130 million Rand a day it costs this economy. And if we know what we can do with 130 million Rand a day from a social perspective, we can do a lot of good in terms of employment, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the South African economic impact, if we look at that, is that when we look at the global non-technical losses, it's equivalent to about or approximately 100 billion US dollars per annum. This is from a global perspective. Reuters in April 23 reported Eskom loses approximately 1 billion US dollars a month as a result of these issues and non-technical losses. The three largest metros in Gauteng lose about 1 million rand a day. Transnet and Prasa spent 2.5 billion Rand roughly a year on security to protect the infrastructure apart from the losses. And as mentioned before, our losses is sort of quantified at 47 billion Rand a year, which is approximately 130 million Rand a day. And once again, just to highlight that we exported copper to the value of almost 1 billion US dollars, which was very important, obviously, from a foreign direct investment perspective. What is the impact on the South African citizen? So current population is roughly about 60 million people. But just to give you some insight, for the 2022-2023 tax year, 2.5 million taxpayers paid approximately 84% of the personal income tax bill, which was roughly 505 billion rand of the fiscus, and approximately 38% of the total revenue collection. So the taxpayers, 2.5 million taxpayers, paid that, as I said, 84%. But if you look at the and you break down the total fiscus that was collected, is that personal tax is still the highest receivable income compared to VAT, to import duties, to companies' taxes, et cetera, et cetera. These same taxpayers are now considering alternatives such as leaving the country, going off grid, and this all exacerbates revenue collection for electrical utilities, notwithstanding reduced revenue from companies. Infrastructure costs increasing, such as the roads due to unserviceable rail network. Social conditions leading to illegal connections, the propensity for business to steal electricity. And this just creates a vicious circle. And when we look at the impact from this in the municipal space, for argument's sake, is that yes, a lot of people are actually going off the grid. And as you know or might know, is that revenue in municipalities, for argument's sake, the largest component is derived from the sale of electricity. Yes, it's also quite a significant cost. But if that is now fallen away, the only profitable income comes from rates and taxes. So somewhere, something has to give. So then rates and taxes will be the next target to start ensuring that revenue is sustained within these particular entities. What compounds the problem in South African utilities, firstly, is employing the incorrect strategy, which is wasteful expenditure. It's believed that SAPS, Metro Police are responsible, but sadly they're not equipped, understaffed, and dedicated internal skills are not aligned. Inadequate comprehension of the full impact of the problem. Budget misappropriation by spending large amounts of money on strategies that don't work, and sadly this gets repeated. Lack of political will to deal with the problem comprehensively. Contract material irregularities, public corruption, and corrupt officials. Poor contract management. In some instances, payment of suppliers within the Municipal Financial Management Act or the PFMA is that suppliers are contracted to do the work but don't get paid. Everyone complains about the problem, but no one does anything about it. So we stick a plaster and we don't administer the antibiotic. And we hope by government intervention, the problem goes away. So in this instances, success is measured on arrest and convictions, and the alignment should be on revenue protection. So what is the legislation? As I said, it's the best in the world. Well, we have three parts of legislation that that is used in the mitigation of this instances. One is the Criminal Matters Amendment Act, and you will see it's a relatively new act. Only 2015 it was inaugurated, and inclusive of that act is the Prevention of Organized Crime Act. So when we look at this particular act, it caters not. In the past, you had to actually commit the offence of stealing a piece of equipment before you would be found guilty. But now it includes the words tamper. So you don't even have to, you just have to open a door on a piece of critical infrastructure and you're already tampering. The punitive measures are quite excessive, imprisonment not exceeding 30 years. Which, by the way, is higher than that what you get for murder. And then the fines not exceeding 100 million rand. So that is quite substantive in terms of what the legislation has put out there. Essential infrastructure means any installation, structure, facility, or system, whether publicly or privately owned. So it's not just municipalities, Eskom, water boards, etc. It's also your own home, where if you have a renewable system installed and it actually gets targeted, it's not just theft. It's actually classed under the Criminal Matters Amendment Act. And then you can all see the definition of tamper. So if I'm digging in a servitude above a cable, I'm already starting to tamper with that servitude and therefore already starting to commit an offense. Further to that, we have the Secondhand Goods Act, which deals with the majority of the scrap metal dealers. But one of the elements within the Criminal Matters Amendment Act, if you are found in possession of possible essential infrastructure equipment, is you don't get charge under the Secondhand Goods Act and get a fine. There's a Section 4 of the Criminal Matters Act, Criminal Matters Amendment Act that now applies, and you actually now get charged under the CMA. Now, when you go to the police station and you actually charge a person or open a case and they have to load it on the CAS system, they need to use Crime Code 3200. And funny enough, we still have a significant amount of problems in actually getting that right. So what is the immediate impact of the legislation? So if we look at Advocate Shamila Batoy in the 2023 financial year report, She indicated that they are doing relatively well. Their benchmark is 80%, and the conviction rate for the year preceding the report was 86.2%. However, when you start to go into the granular effects of this and you actually look at what we are talking about, you'll see from 2019, 20, 21, 22, 23, there's only 631 cases reported in 2019 or charges brought under the MPA with 544 convictions. And if you follow right through to 22, 23, only 1,654 cases, of which 1,417 were successful prosecutions. So that begs the question, there are thousands of cases registered. Why is there so little convictions actually happening? And hopefully throughout the presentation, some of these questions will be answered. So this is a net result we must try and prevent. Containers full of copper leaving our ports. Because if we don't manage the market properly, we're always going to create the environment for this perpetuation of the particular problem. So how is the problem currently managed? So firstly, as I said, we have the best legislation in the world. Then we have the policing, which SAPS have established infrastructure, essential infrastructure task teams. We have the Metro Police, crime wardens, CPFs. We have private security. We have the National Prosecuting Authority. And all of that feeds into a solution or system where the success is measured around arrests and convictions. Now, sadly, this is not abating at the intended rate. So the current strategy is questionable. If we want to deal with this particular problem, or if municipalities, Eskom, Transnet, water boards, etc., are waiting for legislation to start making an impact, by the time this legislation is quite young, it's 2015, and it still needs to get its proper footing for it to actually start making a significant impact. By the time that that happens, municipalities, the Eskoms, the Transnets, etc., all parastatals will have suffered a significant amount of losses. So therefore, we need to start looking at how do we actually deal with it. So what is the panacea for revenue improvement? So when we look at the strategy that is questioned, that is purely just sticking a plaster over the problem. And we need to administer the antibiotic. And how do we do this? The strategy must be revenue protection based. And we must forget about measuring successes around arrests and convictions. We have to start implementing early warning and preventative strategies if we want to start looking at revenue protection and revenue improvement. So how is this done? And this is the paradigm shift thinking that needs to be considered. It cannot be done in isolation. It needs to have a collective approach. So first, in terms of dealing with the problem, there has to be some intelligence. You need to understand what is actually going on. And that comes from the external customer intel, external market intel, internal intel within your own organization, the community and the informant network. Then we have the early warning and preventative strategy, combined with rapid response. And that rapid response must get to the point of incident in less than 15 minutes. With all of that and the movement around, you also create a visible presence. But very important, if you still make arrests on attempts, which you can do under the Criminal Matters Amendment Act, you actually do two things. Firstly, you prevent the revenue loss from occurring. And secondly, you actually helping for convictions to happen under the Criminal Matters Amendment Act. And then lastly, in part of the strategy, you need to manage the actual prosecutions with specialized investigation. There needs to be a legal watching brief, and there needs to be close collaboration with the various state entities. All of this, all of these elements feed back into your threat analysis. But the core of the strategy is around early warning and bespoke technologies and the reaction dispatch. If you don't employ a solution like that and you consider other alternatives in dealing with this, you're just going to continue losing a substantial amount of money. And that takes me to a case study in the city of Ekurhuleni. This case study was in the northern region, and the area that was covered was less than 210 square kilometers. In that, the technology that was deployed was 85 pepper gas systems in substations, some perimeter beams, some mini pepper gas systems in kiosks and meter metering cabinets, 40 transformer alarms, there were some universal alarms, some camera systems, and then also 1,600 early warning underground alarm sensors, which were buried above the cable. 9 reaction vehicles, and there was also a drone and tactical deployment. But the strategy around this was to implement a preventative and early warning with a rapid response approach. These are just some of the technologies in situ that were installed. I won't labor the point here, but that's just to give you some illustrative purpose or indication of some of the technologies installed. And yes, we also had remote surveillance systems. CCTV cameras are good in the applications they're deployed, but they're not the be-all and end-all, and also a very expensive deployment strategy. Just to highlight maybe one strategy or one solution, the bottom right-hand corner where you see the legs, that's actually a COVID camera hidden in a meter box with an investigation with someone that was illegally connecting, disconnecting. That particular individual was charged with 14 charges under the Criminal Matters Amendment Act for tampering and actually connecting and disconnecting illegally into the network. So these are the results. The results that you see in front of you are year-to-date results from January 2020 to September 2022, although the contract ended in December 2022. But just to highlight what you're looking at is the yellow line is the total amount of incidents. The red is the thefts. The green is the attempted thefts. The black line is important. That's a deployment of early warning technologies. And you will see from this that we had significant amount of incidents, certain spikes, and that was the impact of crime displacement and the non-ferrous metal price. Also, this was only a limited budget, so only certain elements could be covered with the technology. And what would generally happen is that the crime would be displaced into areas where there was no technology. However, if you look at the transition point between the thefts and the attempted thefts on the trend lines, the dotted red and the dotted green, it almost took us a year to get this, start getting this under control with the deployment of technologies. And post that transition point, the attempted thefts started to outweigh the actual thefts. Now, that was our mandate, because we can arrest on an attempt, and if someone tries to steal but hasn't actually cut the cable, that's first prize. We just didn't want them to cut the cable. And that then led into presenting these particular stats, probably for easier viewing, between year one, year two, and year three. Our mandate for theft reduction was 10% within this space. In the first year, we reduced the incidents with 7%, but the theft reduction was 33%. In the second year, the incidents started to reduce, this is year on year, 25%, and the theft reduction was 28%. So overall reduction by December 2022 was 72% in theft. And this was done within limitations. And one would note that there was almost no incidents occurring where technology and response was deployed. The incidents were occurring where no technology or response was deployed. But even with that, in the crime displacement and frivolous, we recorded every single instance that was stolen, even if it was a small piece of copper that was cut. So the catalyst for spike in incidents was obviously the copper price and escalating aluminium price. And within that, there was a budget limitation of deployment, which we had to adhere to. So this illustrates the difference between where technologies were deployed and no technologies deployed. So you can see the significant impact that technologies made within this space. The next couple of slides is just to show you the convictions. So there were arrests. There was 15 suspects were convicted, 49 years. But sadly, the problem that occurred is when we left the contract, all those suspects were released because there was no one that was actually going to take over that particular scenario. These are the equipments that were targeted. But in terms of mitigating the problem, which can be done now, is there's so many low-hanging fruits that just needs to be addressed. Compromised assets, equipment locks, housekeeping, contractor management, cable storm management. If you start dealing with those particular problems firsthand, it already will make a significant impact into your overall strategy. So what does the future look like, or what should the future look like in terms of maximum benefit and return on investment to improve the revenue streams? We propose an outcomes-based service delivery model, and this can be an internal or an outsourced particular model. What that service delivery model typically encompasses is all the elements into one fee, and that then is then driven into intended outcomes. And those outcomes are typically the removal of the organized syndicates, fixed cost of deployment, reduce incidents and improve revenue streams. We improve the losses, there's an improve on profitability, ensure return on investment. And we can go through a list of that, but the most important part out of this is now you start holding the service provider responsible and you start implementing punitive measures. What this strategy also allows for is the possibility of a public-private partnership where entities cannot afford a solution. This can be done through businesses getting a solution in place and probably offsetting some of the expenses with the relevant municipalities in the area in terms of discounts on their rates, for argument's sake. So that is something that can definitely be explored. So when we look at the outcomes-based deployment strategy, there are some key elements that we need to consider. The core focus must be to reduce incidents and improve revenue streams at an affordable predetermined budget. These contracts should carry a minimum of 5 years and should not be managed by utility support departments such as ICT. And the reason for that is that they're not accountable actually to the customer. In municipalities, it should actually be managed by an energy department. Because they are accountable and they should be managing these particular contracts. The correct outcomes-based deployment solution is more affordable than the generic security deployment strategy when implemented. To give you some indicative costing, when we started the Ekurhuleni project and we just had to roll out, there were guards and everything, that bill was $8 million a month. When we reduced it, to where all the technologies were deployed, the guards were removed, et cetera, was less than $3 million a month for that area. So there was a significant amount of saving, and you saw what we were managed to achieve in that. It offers a much more improved safety risk element associated with the staff deployment. Instead of having hundreds of people standing and guarding systems which are susceptible to the safety elements, you now have technology that's doing that for you. Early warning and preventative technologies must form part of the implemented strategy. And in this particular case of an outcome should remain the asset of the service provider because technology has a lifespan on it. So if you have a contract and this technology has been deployed, by the time the contract is ending, the customer sits with old technology and actually has to then reinvest in technologies. And should the utility requirement be to procure the technologies, then a consideration for an outcomes-based strategy should be an external approach where you have all these elements collectively put together. You then have specs drawn up, buy the technology, install the technology, become the owner of technology. But you also have a legal watching brief. You have a forensic section. You have a response section, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But as a collective, it gets integrated into the risk management strategy. And very important is now you start to hold service providers accountable with punitive measures. Paying them a lot of money, they need to be able to be up to the task. So primary activities from this strategy is we have to employ a full integrated risk management strategy to prevent these incidents from occurring. There needs to be continuous intelligence threat analysis determination of where the hotspots are. Identify these hotspots, deploy technology, have a response strategy in place that should be less than 15 minutes. Adapted to this is a forensic tactical team that actually deals with hotspot areas and intelligence. And when technology is delayed due to manufacturing and installation, deploy the guards, remove the guards as quick as possible, to reduce the cost of the strategy. Very important is to continuously address the scrap metal market as a primary initiative. In this instance, in the city of Ekurhuleni, we used to do that every single week with the support of the designated second-hand goods officer from the police. Arrests and convictions under the CMA for tampering and the Second-Hand Goods Act as a primary initiative to assist legislation and start making impact. And then don't just stay in dealing with the hotspots. Actually start understanding where the next areas might be and start rolling out technologies into those particular areas. So some recommendations in terms of the strategy is early warning and preventative technologies must form the core of the strategy. You cannot apply a generic solution to a specific problem. And decisions should be based around revenue protection improvement rather than arrests at this stage. Arrests and convictions are currently not improving the situation. We're seeing this daily. Reliance on authorities to improve the situation is at this stage questionable. Expenditure should consider a return on investment that a solution partner would bring. If you employ a service provider dealing with this specific problem, it needs to be factored in what value is that particular service provider going to bring. It should not just be an additional expense to deal with the problem. The problem is not going to go away, as I showed you in terms of what's happening in the copper market. And this is just going to be exacerbated by the copper demand. And it will come from the recycle industry because the mines cannot keep up supplying. The possibility to investigate private-public partnerships as an opportunity in starting to deal with this particular problem. And you want a partnership that understands the problem, knows what they're doing, takes accountability for their action, provides a cost-benefit analysis which is much less than the generic strategy, and helps improve the revenue and profitability goals, therefore improve service delivery to its customers. This is just in closing to show you a particular problem, and then we can conclude. Thank you very much, everybody, for your valuable time. You will see in the bottom right-hand corner is a QR code. If you scan that, you'll get my personal details. Should you wish to engage me after this webinar, send me an email or so, and I'll be most willing to accommodate you. Minks, thank you very much for the opportunity. And I would also like to thank the Institute for the opportunity in giving this platform so that we can actually share what we have done and our successes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Quentin. That was extremely informative. Ladies and gentlemen, we're now going over to questions. And please type your questions in the questions panel, and we'll ask either to Gavin or Quentin to answer your questions. Gavin, you mentioned in the beginning that you have a question, that you have a few questions. I'll let you open the floor while we wait for questions to be posted.
Yes, I actually don't have any specific questions at this stage, but just to say that what Quentin's done is commendable because he's got a lot of cold hard facts. You know, it's for anyone to see the objective improvements with certain strategies that have been, and also the background of that was extremely factual and informative. So we know how all these systems interrelate. So well done to Quentin. He really did a great job and was extremely interesting for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Gavin. At the moment, I don't have any questions. Ladies and gentlemen, while we wait for the questions, just look at the chat box for links to SIIE, how to become a member of the SIIE, and also the CPD training calendar for upcoming courses, and of course, the old September issue of What Now. When I loaded this, registered this webinar, it was still September, and I haven't completed the October issue. So, but you'll find that in the handout section, the PDF copy of the October issue. Seeing that we don't have questions, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to make contact with Quinton from Tarmo Technologies, please send me an email, minx@saiee.org.za, and then I will forward your email to him. I just want to then use this opportunity to thank Quinton and Gavin for your time this afternoon, for doing this webinar. It's really, really informative. And yes, it is a problem that we live with every day. Thank you very much, everyone, for attending. And watch out the SIIE website for upcoming webinars. Thank you and have a good night. Goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.